Father, we thank you tonight for your word and the time we can spend in it and the things that are here tonight, the clarity that these things bring to our life and ministry. In Christ's name, amen. Now, we were answering questions on Sunday night now for some time. This is actually the 42nd, I think, week we're doing this. And I've not been trying to answer questions that we get all the time. There's standard questions that you get and that come and so forth. But I've been trying to pick out questions that are a little different, interest kind of things. And the last few, probably the last 3 weeks, I've gotten a number of really personal type questions. And I decided I'm going to save them until after the Bible conference. But tonight I was going to answer a question that comes at least probably twice a month. And it's a very common question, and yet it's one that strikes at the very heart of what we do. And that's the question, Brother Rick, why don't you guys follow the Great Commission? Do y'all really believe in missions? If you do, how could you not keep the Great Commission? Now, I've said to you before, if you study church history, you discover that the term, the Great Commission, well, if you study the Bible, it's not in the Bible. Okay? That's not a Bible term. That's a missionary conference raise money term. It came into the vocabulary of the church back in the 1800s when missionaries in India and Burma and China were trying to raise money from Americans and Europeans, Americans and British people mainly, to support missions. And Judson and Carey and those great famous missionaries in Asia, they were seeking to raise money, and so they developed a catchphrase to try to encourage people to think about missions. That's why when you see a missionary conference, it's always about the Great Commission. I've actually seen in Grace churches banners at missionary conference, quote Mark 16:15, go you into all the world, preach the gospel. So, and they only take that much of the verse. Is that connected to the warp and woof of mission activity? And they did a good job of advertising and raising money for missions. But it's really an advertising slogan. It's not Bible at all. And the reason for the hesitancy about the Great Commission is we ask somebody, well, what is the Great Commission? And somebody will say, well, it's Matthew 28. Somebody else says Mark 16. Somebody else says Luke 24. Somebody else says Acts 1. Nobody but the Catholic says it's John 20. But the Great Commission really begins in Matthew chapter 10. But I want you to see a verse before we get there. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 3 and 4. 1 Timothy 2, 3 and 4. This is a good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. That's what we're about as a ministry. That's what your life, your home, your family, your life needs to be fundamentally focused on that issue. It's not raising money. It's not getting organizations and religion things going. It's getting people saved, first your family, and then the nest you live in, then the world about you. And when you get people saved, get them saved out of the bondage of religious tyranny into an understanding of God's grace. So the real issue for us is to see people get saved and save people to get established in the truth. There's a couple of us here this morning. They're talking about how many decades they spent in the bondage of religious tyranny under the legalism of a Pentecostal system that had them afraid all the time. The man said, you don't understand how wonderful it is just to know I'm saved. And I'm not scared of losing it every time I turn around and every time I don't do something right. He said, if I stumped my toe and said a bad word, I thought I had to go get saved again. Just to have the security that's there in Christ, that we rejoice in that, and yet we can also remember what it's like not to be there. That's get saved and come to the knowledge of what God's really doing today. So that's really what we're about. And the arguments and the discussions about the Great Commission and that question itself indicates a lack of understanding of what the church, the body of Christ's ministry really is about. The Southern Baptist Convention, come back with it in Matthew 10, which is the largest Protestant denomination in America. is going through right now a shift in thinking. And what they're doing is they're trying to get rid of being called Southern Baptist. And the reason for that is that one, they're not all in the South anymore. But the other is some of their history. And you say, well, then what are we going to be called? We're going to be called the Great Commission Baptist. And that's the name that their leaders are preferring them to be called. And you say, well, why is that? Because we keep, and this is the Rick Warren phrase, we follow the Great Commission in the spirit of the Great Commandment. And that's a nice kind of a selling thing, but it's all just a bunch of talk. It's just more religious mumbo jumbo. We're going to follow the Great Commission in the spirit of the Great Commandment. That is, you love the Lord thy God with all your heart and all your soul and your neighbor like yourself. Well, that's got nothing to do with anything in the Scripture about these passages. So you have this religious activity as opposed to what the actual verses talk about. And the reason we don't follow the post-resurrection commission of Christ is because that's not got anything to do with us. That's just the bottom line of it. It has nothing to do with the fact that you aren't interested in seeing people get saved, because that's what Paul said, that's the will of God is. It hasn't got anything to do with sin wanting to or not wanting to see people that are saved get grounded in the Word. So what about the Great Commission, so-called? Now, most of the time when people talk about it, they're talking about the time between Christ's resurrection and his ascension, that 40 days, four different occasions he gives commandments and instructions to his apostles, Matthew 28, Mark 16, Luke 24, John 20, and Acts chapter 1. And that's called the last marching orders. Well, of course, you understand that's not true, because he spoke again from heaven to the Apostle Paul with a new system of information. So that's dispensation, that's where you are. But the Great Commission started in Matthew chapter 10. So go back there with me. If you want the Great Commission, I'm going to draw a timeline on the board in a minute, and you'll see that each one of those post-resurrection commissions focuses on a particular point on the timeline. Matthew 10 covers the whole timeline. So if you want the Great Commission, you'd want the whole one. Well, that's Matthew 10, verse number 1. When he, that's Christ, had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Now, the name of the 12 apostles are these. And you notice in verse 1, they are disciples. Excuse me. He gives them power, authority to act in his stead, and then they are 12 apostles. This is the ordination of the 12 apostles into their apostleship. They're no longer going to just be disciples. Now they're going to be 12 apostles who are destined to sit upon 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel, Matthew 19, 28 says. So these are men who put in leadership, rulership, authority position over the nation Israel. Verse number 5, he lists their names in verse 2, 3, and 4. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, here's their commission. Go not into the way of the Gentiles, in any city of the Samaritans enter you not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now, immediately you know you have a problem if that's what you're supposed to do. He said, I follow the Lord. Well, what does he say there? Don't preach in Chicago. I look around here, don't preach to almost all of you. He said, well, what's that? It's what it says it is. So where are you to preach? You're not to preach in Chicago. You go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And when he came looking for them, where did he come looking for them? He didn't come looking for them in Chicago or Miami. He came looking for them in Israel, Palestine. And as you go preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the leper, raise the dead, cast out the devils. Freely you receive, freely you give. Freely give. Provide neither gold nor silver nor brass for your purse. Now, you know, The more you read, the deeper you get into it. You got all these miraculous signs and wonders, and then you don't take a collection. You ever see anybody follow this passage? I mean, they developed the term Great Commission to take collections. And then he says, don't do that. Now, if you come with me down to verse number 19. And when they shall deliver you up, take no thought how or what you shall speak, for it shall be given you in that same hour what you shall speak. For it is not ye that speak, but the Spirit of your Father which speaketh in you. Now, when does that take place historically? That takes place beginning at Pentecost. Until the day of Pentecost, hold your hand here and come to John chapter number 7. Until the day of Pentecost, they don't have the Holy Spirit speaking in them. So what I want you to see here is that this commission in Matthew 10 goes along a timeline. He starts out where they are. He starts out where he's sending them out to do things. And then progressively along. So you're going to progress along in Matthew 10 from the ordination of the 12 all the way through Pentecost, the Holy Spirit coming, then all the way through the tribulation, the seventh week of Daniel, to the coming of Christ at his kingdom. So this is a commission that's going to carry them from their ordination all the way through the tribulation into Christ coming in the kingdom. That's why I say this is the whole shebang in one chapter. John chapter 7, verse 39. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believed on him should receive. For the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. The Holy Spirit doesn't come until Christ is resurrected, seated at the Father's right hand, and then sends the Holy Spirit as the gift of the Father. And that's what happened on the day of Pentecost. So in Matthew 10, verse 20, that verse can't happen until after Pentecost. So the point is that you're moving through the timeline here. Now, if you come back to Matthew chapter 10, verse 22, you shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved. Now, you've read that verse somewhere else before, haven't you? Look with me over at Matthew 24. He that endureth to the end shall be saved. That's one of the verses people love to quote to tell you that you have to endure. And if you don't endure, then you're not saved. Because that's what the verse says. The issue in that verse is don't try to change the verse. Just realize it's not talking about you. Matthew 24, verse 13. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom. So what gospel are we talking about being preached? The gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for witness unto all nations. Then shall the end come. The end of what? Verse 15. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet stand in the holy place, whosoever readeth. That's talking about the Antichrist. That's talking about the 70th week of Daniel. He's quoting Daniel chapter 8 and Daniel chapter 9, and that takes place in the middle of the 70th week. So the issue about he that endureth to the end is during to the end of that 70th week of Daniel. So where you are in Matthew 10 is you're in the middle of the tribulation. Now look at Matthew 10, 23. And they that persecute you in this city, when they persecute in this city, flee unto another. For verily I say unto you, now watch, ye shall not have gone over the cities of Israel till the Son of Man be come. Guys, before you get finished doing what I'm telling you, I'll be back. Now I want you to remember that verse because you're going to see it show up again in the post-resurrection commissions. But if you go down through the thing, he goes all the way down through his coming back and establishing his kingdom. So Matthew 10, the real great commission, is the whole scope of what the apostles are to do from their ordination back here in the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Christ dies, he ascends into heaven, sends the Holy Spirit back. All of that information is there. Then there's going to be the tribulation period, the 70th week of Daniel over here. And that's talked about. And then his coming over here when they've gone over the cities of Israel. So Matthew 10 takes them from Matthew 10, where they're ordained, all the way over to the kingdom, to when the kingdom begins over here. Christ comes, sits on the throne, and they sit with him. So that's a whole timeline in one passage. Now, if you come with me to the post-resurrection commissions, during this 40 days of time, when Christ, he's resurrected, I didn't do it very well, though we can't see it. You guys in the back can't see it anywhere, can you? He's resurrected, he dies, he comes up, he spends 40 days with them here, then he ascends into heaven, the Holy Spirit comes on the day of Pentecost 10 days later. During this period of time right here, he gives them further instructions. They've got the big picture. Now he's going to localize and focus on four, or on five really, different issues. Come with me to Matthew 28. Now here's the most of the time you hear the term Great Commission, people talking about Matthew 28. Books, magazine articles, denominational programs for ages. We get them here constantly in the mail. Here's how to have revival in your church. Here's how to have the ministry. Here's what you ought to be doing. Here's how to structure what you're doing. And it's go ye, Matthew 28, verse 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you, and lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. So we've got to go out and teach all. Go out and make disciples of everybody. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And then teach them to observe all things I've commanded you. Now, hold your hand here and come back to Matthew chapter 5. One of the things that people, when they talk about the teachings of Jesus, they always talk about, and rightly so, they talk about the Sermon on the Mount. The first thing in the book of Matthew you have is the presentation of the king presenting the constitution and platform of his kingdom, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. So when you do Matthew 28, you're going to teach people to observe. When he says, go, you're there for and teach all, what do you teach them? Everything I've commanded you. In Matthew chapter 5, verse number 19. Whosoever, Matthew 5, 19, therefore shall break one of these least commandments. Now what's he talking about? Verse 17. Think not that I'm come to destroy the law of the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. Verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot, one tittle, shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments, one of these least commandments of the law, and shall teach men so, he should be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be great, called great in the kingdom of heaven. Now think, wait a minute. If I want to be great in the kingdom, what do I have to do? Teach these commandments. Matthew 28, go ye therefore and teach all nations. What? What I've commanded you. What did he command them? He commanded them to go teach the law. What did Paul say? You're not under the law, but you're under grace. Can you understand why this couple that's here this morning, we talk about the legalism in the denomination they're in, when that denomination is trying to fulfill the Pentecostal order? They're actually trying to do what Matthew 28 says. So they put you under the law. They put you under a performance-based system that if you don't perform, God won't accept you. And if God don't like it, I don't like it too. And so where they get that out of Matthew. They get that out of, that's the program. That's exactly what they're going to be doing in that kingdom. Now go back with him to Matthew 28 and get Hebrews chapter 8, just so we can mess things up a little more. I mean, you get the legalism in Matthew, the signs and wonders in the baptism of salvation in Luke, in Mark, the Jerusalem first in Luke and Acts, and then heaven to Murgatroyd and John, where they can forgive sins. I saw nobody but the Catholics like that, or the Catholic sympathizing Protestants. Anglicans and Lutherans, you know, the priest. And you say, whoa. All of a sudden, it's not just, oh, we're going to have a missionary conference, go win some little people to Jesus. It's, we got real confusion. And the problem with that is that somebody somewhere along the way is going to read the verses and say, why aren't we doing what the verses say? Matthew 28. I love this one. Matthew 28, verse 18. Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore. Why? Because all power is mine in heaven and earth. Based upon him having absolute control and power, you go do this. On that timeline behind it, when is it that he has absolute control and power? In the kingdom. Look at verse 20. Teaching them to observe all things I've commanded you, and lo, I am what? With you. When is he with them on that chart? He's with them over here, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. He ascends up and goes away and isn't coming back till the kingdom. Matthew 28, the gospel of the kingdom, is a commission that will only be fulfilled by those apostles and that little flock in the kingdom. Let me show you how you know that absolutely. Verse number 19. Go ye therefore and teach what? All nations. Did you get Hebrews 8? Okay, do like that and go back with me to Numbers chapter 23. And write this verse down by Matthew 28, 19. Numbers 23. And you can find out in a half heartbeat whether people actually believe their Bible or they just say they do. I was looking at a thing. We got folks going to go down to the Ark and the Creation Museum. And Answers in Genesis, they're very bold about saying, we believe the Bible. We believe the creation account of the Bible. And I've watched Ken Ham teach and stand up and say, this is the infallible Word of God. I know a guy went and asked him, do you believe the one in your hands? He said, well, no. I meant in the original languages, in the autographs. He uses an ESV. An ESV is not the infallible, inerrant Word of God. It's got mistakes. It leaves verses out of the Bible. It adds things into the Bible that shouldn't be there, and it makes mistakes about what it puts in. It's not the pure Word of truth. So they profess what they believe, what people believe, people that don't understand the Bible issue, they say they believe what they believe is their doctrinal statement about what's in the Bible, more than they believe the Bible it comes out of. And you want to find out if somebody really believes the Bible or they just believe their system? Go ye therefore and teach all nations. Numbers 23, verse 9. From the top of the rocks, I see him. That's Balaam seeing Israel. From the hills, I beheld him. Behold him. Lo, the people of Israel, shall dwell alone and shall, underline the next word, not be reckoned among the nations. I drew that chart on the wall this morning. Israel's circumcision, Gentiles' uncircumcision. God separated his people. They dwell as no other nation in the earth. They're his solitary nation, the only nation in the earth that belonged to him. And he said, don't reckon them among... When you talk about the nations, don't include Israel. When Jesus Christ says, go make disciples, go teach all nations, that's a commission that excludes teaching Israel. I know a friend, I had a friend years ago, he's with the Lord now, he was down in Miami, Florida, and he had a mission called Mission to the Jews. And that was his text, Matthew 28, 19. And I asked him, I said, dear brother, in Matthew 28, 19, you can't preach to Jews. And he looked at me like, well, sure I can. I said, I know you can, but not on the basis of that verse. And, well, the long and short of it was, it wasn't my friend much longer. That's fascinating. You say, well, why would he say don't preach to the Jews? Look at Hebrews chapter 8. In Hebrews 8, verse number 8, for finding fault with them, he saith, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. So here's the new covenant. Not according to the covenant that I will make with their fathers, which I made with their fathers in the day when I took them out of by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. Now watch, I will put my laws in their minds and write them in their heart, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people, and they, watch, shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least to the greatest. It's only, the verse in Romans 11, so all Israel shall be saved. It's only redeemed Israel that goes into the kingdom. Then they won't say to their neighbors, other Jews, know the Lord, because they're already redeemed. It's going to be redeemed Israel that takes that message of salvation out to the nations. Matthew 28 is the commission that God gives to redeemed Israel. They get in the kingdom, all the glory. What are we supposed to do? There it is. So Matthew 28, literally, on the timeline of what their future was, it fits exactly, doctrinally, what they're going to do in that kingdom, because they're going to go out and teach the law. And from Jerusalem, Isaiah 2 says, the law is going to go out and fill the earth. So Matthew 28 is exactly what redeemed Israel will do in that kingdom when, by the way, the Lord Jesus Christ has all authority. And he's, lo, I am with you always. All the way through it, I'm with you. That's a commission that is given with a view of Christ being present with them. Not mystically, not by his spirit, but him. Come with me to Mark, chapter 16. Mark presents the Lord Jesus Christ as the servant. Mark 16, verse 15. Now here's another. We're studying Mark on Wednesday night. We're almost ready to get into chapter 16. The last part of this chapter, verse 9 to the end, most the new Bibles leave it out or put a mark that it shouldn't be there. You read these verses, you can see why they do it. Verse 15, he said unto them, talking to his disciples, verse 11, the 11, go ye into all the world, preach the gospel. So now they're not just going to preach to, they're going to go everywhere, unrestricted, not just Israel. What gospel are they going to preach to every creature? Well, 2 days before this, I'm sorry, 3 days, this is the morning of the evening of the resurrection. 3 days before Christ is crucified, 2 days before he's crucified, he spoke the Olivet Discourse. We read the passage in Matthew 24 a minute ago where he says that this gospel of the kingdom should be preached in all the world and all the nations for witness. See, 5 days before he says this, three of which he was dead, he said, go preach the gospel of the kingdom. Can you find in your Bible a time in those 5 days where Jesus changed the gospel? No. So the gospel he's talking about is the gospel of the kingdom. Repent and believe the gospel. The kingdom of heaven's at hand. It's the message of the kingdom. He that believeth, verse 16, and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. I was talking to a denominational preacher one time. He got real mad at me about, I used to make people mad all the time. I quit talking to people, so don't make so many people mad. And he was telling me this is his commission. I said, well, tell me something. How do you get saved? He said, you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. I said, anything else? He said, no. I said, okay, I'm going to ask you a question. I just want you to read me verse 16. Don't say anything. I'm going to ask you, what must I do to be saved? And you read me verse 16. Okay? What must I do to be saved? He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. See, all you got to do is believe. Well, if your mind thinks that way, there's something different in the way you think and the way I think. Because that is what the verse says. It says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. And old Campbellite used to say on the radio, he says, he that eateth and digests gets nourishment. That's the same thing. You eat, you believe, and you're baptized because you believe, and you get saved. That's clear enough. He that believes not shall be damned. It doesn't make any difference what you do if you don't have faith. None of it helps. But if you have faith, what would you do? You get baptized. The baptismal salvation in that passage is a thorn in the flesh of people that want to follow the Great Commission. Because almost none of them believe that you ought to be baptized to be saved. I think you need to get water baptized, but not for salvation, preacher. But then what's that verse talking about? And that's your linchpin verse. It gets better. Verse 17, these signs shall follow them that believe. This is not a suggestion. This is what's going to happen. In my name they shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. I heard Charles Stanley one time years ago. He was talking about that. See, when you get saved, God casts the devil out of you, and then you quit cussing. Well, Charlie, that's the best you can do. I guess, you know, work on it a little bit. But they should take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it should not hurt them. Many years ago, when I was brass and smart aleck, I used to carry a little can of Drano around with me in my briefcase. And you meet somebody, so I said, there, try that out. You know, I never had anybody even suggest that they'd do it. Well, the verse says, if they drink any deadly thing, it won't hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. They're claiming to heal people. Well, before you got to that, it said you could drink Drano. You can't pick and choose out of Scripture and be honest. And you say, what is that? Well, tell me something. Is there going to be a period of time that the apostles, the little flock, is going to face when they're going to need to be able to cast out devils? When they're going to need to speak with new tongues? That is, there are going to be so many, the people they're going to minister to. Well, go back with me, if you will. Zechariah chapter 3. We got time to do this. Book of Zechariah, chapter 13. Zechariah 13, verse 1. In that day, and that's the day when Christ comes and they see him, verse chapter 12, verse 10, I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplication, and they shall look upon me whom they've pierced. Revelation 1, 7, that's the second advent. When Christ comes back, sets up his kingdom, in that day there shall be a fountain open to the house of David and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem for sin and for uncleanness. We got a song, there's a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein, and sinners plunge beneath the floods, you lose all their guilty stains. Great song, true. That's the verse that it was written on. And that verse hadn't got anything to do about with blood. You know what's in that fountain? Yeah. He that believeth and is baptized. Ezekiel 36, it says, I'll sprinkle you with clean water and I'll cleanse you from the filthiness of your idolatry. I'll cleanse you. Is it come to pass in that day, verse 2, saith the Lord of hosts, that I will cut off the name of the idols out of the land, and they shall no more be remembered. And also I will cause the prophets and the unclean spirits to pass out of the land. You know what they're going to do? They're going to throw Satan and all of his minions out. Remember that dude in Mark 5? Jesus talks to the devils in him, and he says, I'm legion, for we're many. And he says, get out. And the devil says back to him, please don't cast us out of the land. They didn't care about getting cast out of the guy. Their job was to corrupt the land and hold the land. And it goes all the way back to the book of Joshua when Satan had invaded the land with the, I love these titles, the sons of Belial. I mean, that just sounds bad, you know, so it's almost like Beetlejuice. And they're going to, and he says, I'm going to liberate the land from Satan and throw the devil out. They weren't just going around casting out devils just to be, well, you know, there's Aunt Tilly and she's got a bad toe and I think I'll fix her toe with cast out. They weren't casting out demons of rum and demons of depression. Those aren't demons. That's just sins of the flesh. But those satanic devils were there trying to oppose what God's doing and reclaiming the earth. And these people are going to cast them out. Then he says they're going to speak with new tongues. Look at Zechariah chapter 8, verse 23. Again, this is talking about the second coming of Christ. Zechariah 8, 23, thus saith the Lord of hosts, in those days it shall come to pass that 10 men shall take hold out of all languages of the nations, even shall take hold of the skirt of him that is a Jew, saying, we will go with you, for we have heard that God is with you. Now, if 10 dudes came up and got a hold to you and said, we want to hear what God has to say, and they speak 10 different languages, what would you need to do? Stop and go take a Rosetta Stone or Babylon class real quick, right? You can learn to speak a foreign language in, what did they say, 3 months? No, they want to hear today. And the tongue talking had to do with being able to do that. That's why they spoke in tongues on the day of Pentecost. There are people from all different kinds. There are Jews in Jerusalem from all different kinds of nations. He lists them for you. And they said, how is it that we hear these men speak, every one of us, in our own language? Because that's what tongues does. Tongue's not some kind of thing to make a bunch of gibberish kind of hootenanny in a church service. That thing of Sid Roth that Alex was playing, just the total tomfoolery of that. 1 Corinthians 14, he says, unsaved men come in and see that, they think you're mad. I'm saved and I think they're mad. But it's not what this passage is talking about. Go back to Mark 16. I'm going to move on, but what I want you to see is the things that these signs are doing is giving them the capacity to function through this time of satanic oppression against the believer in Israel, where he's trying to destroy them. That's a commission specifically that they're going to follow in the tribulation period. He says they take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it won't hurt them. Look at Revelation 6, where they have wild beasts. Revelation 8, where they drink wormwood. The water's poison, bitter. It doesn't kill them. Lay hands on the sick, and they'll recover. So, verse 19, so then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat at the right hand of God. When that commission is being fulfilled, Christ isn't with them on the earth. He's at the right hand of God in the heavens. He's gone. That's a commission to be fulfilled during his absence, specifically in that time of Jacob's trouble and satanic oppression. Now come with me to Luke chapter 24 and get Luke 24 and Acts chapter 1, because these two, one is volume 1, volume 2. One of the great things you can do as you're reading through your Bible is to read the book of Luke and the book of Acts together. Luke wrote both books. You see that in the first few verses of each one of them. Luke is like volume 1. Acts is volume 2. And when you read them together, what you discover is that there are thoughts, there's terms, there's expressions that Luke will use in Luke, talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, that he will then use in the book of Acts, talking about the ministry of the apostles. And it's a fascinating kind of a thing back and forth. Many years ago, back in the late 80s, a pastor out in Ohio, he suggested that to me. And I thought that sounded, so I started doing it. And for, I guess, 20, 40 years, I've been reading those two books together. I never read one without the other. Not ever, but most of the time. And you just see the flow. So Luke 24 and Acts 1 are sort of, they're sort of like this. So when Christ gives the commission to the apostles in Luke 24, verse number 45, then opened he their understanding, that they might understand the Scriptures. And he said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, what? Beginning at Jerusalem. So where, if you're going to follow the Luke 24 commission, where do you start? You don't start in Chicago. Now, the way the preachers get around it is they take the comparative passage in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But ye shall receive power after, and by the way, in Luke 24, verse 49, "And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high." So when when he goes out after the 40 days, he's going to be ascended into heaven. Luke records this in Acts 1, verse 8. "But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and in the uttermost part of the earth." So where do you start when the Holy Spirit comes? You start in Jerusalem, then Judea, then Samaria. Now what the preachers tell you is that, well, Jerusalem is your hometown. Judea, that's the county around. Samaria, that's your territory. And then go to the world. So what you organize your ministry, reach your hometown, then reach the area around it, then reach the area beyond that, and then go to the world. Now the problem with that is Jerusalem is not in Illinois. Now there is a Jerusalem, Illinois, but that's not this one. You know where this one is? It's in the Middle East. Get a map, look it up. Beside that, and this is where that statement is so, just so cuckoo. Verse number 11. Verse 10. "And while they stood, looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which said, also said, ye men of Jerusalem." These guys didn't live in Jerusalem. Jerusalem wasn't their hometown. They're from Galilee. Now, you know where Galilee is? That's up north. Jerusalem's in Judah. Down south, the southern kingdom. Galilee is the northern territory. Now, you know, you guys are smart enough to know the difference from being from up north and down south. That couple that was here this morning, I asked them, "Well, how did you come into some of this information?" And they said, "We were in Fairhope, Alabama." I said, "That's interesting. That's where I'm from." That's right across the bay from Mobile. My wife's family lives in Daphne, right next to Fairhope. "Oh, yeah, well, that's where we stay, in Daphne." I said, "Isn't that interesting? You know where that is? That's down south. That's as far as you can go in Alabama, not getting the Gulf of Mexico. But when you're up here, that's 1,000 miles away." I'd never say that Fairhope is my hometown. I live in Bloomingdale, Illinois. These guys, preachers make up stuff so they can use the Bible to do whatever they want to do. He wasn't saying reach your hometown. He's saying reach Jerusalem. You know why? Because that's the city of the great king. And he said, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria. What did that verse in Matthew 10 say? You will not be going over the cities of Israel until what? The Son of Man be come. Go to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and before you get through with all the cities of Israel, the kingdom's gone. I'm going to be back. And then in the kingdom, we'll go out and possess the earth. Now, when he says in that verse, to the uttermost parts of the earth, write down Psalm chapter 2, verse 8, where the Son says to the Father, and the Father says to the Son, I'm going to give you the uttermost parts of the earth for possession in the kingdom. You see, these verses mean something to the people that were spoken to about what they, you can't just pull them out and make out like, and just put a meaning on them that doesn't fit. So the Luke and the Acts, Mark's going to fit in the trib. Luke and Acts are going to be their commission for the book of Acts. That's what they're to be doing from here to when the seventh week begins. So I hope you can see what's going on here. The original commission takes the whole thing. And then here, he segments. That whole thing is going to be done in an orderly fashion. Now, come with me, if you will, to John chapter 20. Because this is the one most Protestants don't like. So this one doesn't get to go to church very often. John 20, verse 19. Then the same day at even, being the first day of the week, it's resurrection day, when the doors, and this is the day he gave those most of those other ones, that when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and said to them, peace be unto you. And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his feet. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then Jesus said unto them again, peace be unto you. As my Father has sent me, so send I you. See the as and so? There's a great song we used to sing, so send I you to labor unrewarded. Any of you know that? You know that song? Most of you guys never been around. I'll tell you, you missed a lot. And it's a great missionary song. So send I you to labor unrewarded, and so on and so forth. That's the verse it comes off of. Great missionary song. But notice he says, so send I you. As my Father sent me, so send I you. Come with me to Luke 22. How did the Father send him? Well, the way he says that in Luke 22 is fascinating. Luke 22, verse number 28. Luke 22, 28. Ye are they, he's talking to his apostles now, which have continued with me in my temptations. And I appoint unto you a what? Kingdom, as my Father hath appointed unto me. That ye may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. My Father appointed me a kingdom. And as my Father appointed me a kingdom, I'm appointing you a part in it too. And you got 12 thrones to sit on the judging 12 tribes of Israel. So when it says, as my Father has sent me, so send I you, that's not talking about missionaries in the dispensation of grace. Now verse 22, John 20, verse 22, and when he had said this, he breathed on them and said, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins ye remit, they're remitted unto them. And whosoever sins you retain, they're retained. He literally gives them authority to act in his stead. Only God can forgive sin. Or the one he sends. The spiritual authority that he gave to these apostles to sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes. He didn't give it to failing men like you and me. He first gave them the Holy Spirit. They're filled with the Spirit. And he does to those 12 what Moses did back in Numbers and Deuteronomy when he set judges over his people. And they were to act in Moses' stead. And when they said it, it was Moses' word. So he literally gives these apostles authority to act in his absence, in his stead. As I said, Protestants don't like that very much. But he sends them out with his authority. These commissions, in everything they do, by the way, they have that authority after the Spirit comes, they fit and they work. When you try to pull them out of there, they don't work. Now come with me quickly because it's way past time to quit. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and Ephesians chapter 3. You'll say, well then what is our commission? Well, if you need a commission, your commission is you've been put in trust with the gospel. And you've been put in trust with the gospel as an adult. That's what you do. You trust adults. I trust you with my message. I trust you to be a good steward of it. Paul said, if a man account of us, let him count of us as ministers of God and stewards of the mysteries of God. We're going to be faithful stewards. We have his trust, and we're going to keep trust. We're going to function like adults with his message. So, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16. Wherefore, henceforth, know we no man after the flesh. Yea, though we've known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth we know him no more. We don't follow Christ after his fleshly ministry. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. All that old program's over. Now you have a new program. and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given unto us the ministry of music. No. There's only one minister in the dispensation of grace, and it's the minister of reconciliation. That would save a lot of people a lot of money and a lot of confusion. What's the ministry of reconciliation? To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world and himself, not imputing the trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, as ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. The ministry of reconciliation is a bunch of ambassadors going out and proclaiming grace and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, and inviting people who are at war with him to come and have peace. How's that possible? For God made him to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. That's our ministry. It's not kingdom building. It's not machinery building. It's gospel preaching. It's body building, building up the church, the body of Christ, getting people saved out of Adam into Christ. That's our ministry. Ephesians chapter 3 says it this way. Paul says, be you followers of me, even as I am of Christ. Well, then, here's how you follow Paul. Here's how Paul did it. Ephesians 3, verse 7, wherefore I was made a minister, according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, what? That I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, from the beginning of the world been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. You know what our calling is, what our function is? Chapter 4, he says, walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you're called. Your calling into the body of Christ has a job associated with it, has some good works associated with it. We're his workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God before ordained that we should walk in them. God had a plan for the body of Christ. It has to do with making known the fellowship of the mystery, putting it on display, and preaching among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. Things you can't find any place other than in this message of his grace. That's commission enough. You don't need to go to places in the Bible that have nothing to do with you and try to assimilate things that God isn't doing today. What you need to do is be a part of what he is doing. Take that, get serious about it. Take Paul's example. We've talked to you many times about Paul's methods and his model, ministry model. His ministry model is he'd go into town, preach the gospel, get some people saved, then gather those people together and start edifying them, get the edification process going so that the word of God's working affection in them to believe, then turn the ministry over to them to go out and repeat the process. And he says in 2 Corinthians, he said, I got a rule, a ministry rule, that reached to you, and I always follow it so that I can reach to go out to the regions beyond. And that is, I don't go any further in the ministry than people getting saved, people getting edified, and then them sending us out. I don't reach further than what the work actually does. I said, that's a pretty good idea. So you don't need to follow a bogus set of religious instructions to try to make out like you're doing something God that pleases God. Just relax, be who you are in Christ, and enjoy God's word rightly divided. And let me ask you, how many times in the past week, say month, expand it a little bit, have you shared the gospel with someone? You say, how many times did you just leave a tract somewhere? Gospel tract, preaches the gospel. You know, when I was coming up as a young man, you never went anywhere without a pocket full of gospel tracts. New Testament in my back pocket, and I got it on my phone, got the whole Bible. But you know, you're never going to have the chance to share the gospel if you aren't equipped and thinking about it. People say, well, nobody wants to believe what we believe. You know what? You did. Got to be somebody else as dumb as you are in the neighborhood. You know, There are people out there that need to hear the gospel, need to be saved. And the answers aren't in the world. The answers aren't in philosophy. The answers aren't in religion. And the world we live in realizes that. And they're looking. And they're not willing just to be cultural. That was something real. People talk about reaching young people. Just be real. You'll scare them to death. Because they're looking. That's what everybody's looking for. Something that actually satisfies the heart. And only truth does that. And only the Lord Jesus Christ. And instead of spending your time, this is why I don't do this Facebook and all that stuff. Instead of spending your time arguing how many angels can dance on the head of a needle, some obscure passage in the book of Acts that's not going to make any difference to anybody except you that you got it right. I make people mad at me now. Why don't you just take an opportunity to go stand on the corner, pass some tracts out. Lady down in Las Vegas years ago, Rena Jaquith, she and her husband have been missionaries 13 years in Israel. They got kicked out, went to Morocco, and were there till he died. She came back and located in Las Vegas because she needed a hot climate. My son and I were there one time and visiting with her, and she had this little storefront with her ministry in it. And she said, you know, Brother Rick, people get mad at me. I'm a woman. And the Grace Church here, they won't have anything to do with me because they say they don't believe in women preachers. And she said, I don't believe in women preachers either. But, you know, I just come down. I'm here. And I just took some tracts and stood down on the street corner and passed out tracts. And is it my fault somebody wanted to know how to get saved? I said, no, Rena, I think the Lord will forgive you. Is it my, you know, I gave the tracts out and got to get saved. Next thing you know, a woman gets saved. Next thing you know, I got 4 or 5 people been saved. Is it my fault that they want to learn and I start teaching them? I said, no, that kind of makes sense. She said, this one guy gets saved, and he says, you know, Rena, you shouldn't be standing on the street corner down here. I've got a building up here, and I've got a storefront. Why don't you just come in and have that storefront? He said he set the building up for it, put tables in it. Another guy gets saved. He says, I'm a sign painter. I'll paint you a sign on the front. She had a right division chart painted on the window in the front. And you know what? She never went out and did any of that. Just pass tracks, see if people get saved. It started with getting some people saved. And I hear people all the time say, we don't have a Grace Church. Well, why don't you look out there at lost people and say, there's the future member of the body of Christ. I've told you before, I came out of a restaurant one time down in Tennessee, and it was a place like a Denny's. And there are these biker guys standing out, sitting in the lobby, you know, where you have to sit and wait, and they look like hell warmed over. And there I am with my face hanging out looking at them, and I thought, well, I can either slink away or I can go and talk to them. So I said, I'll just go talk to them, see what happens. And I went over and I said, guys, I'm sorry you're having to wait, but here, let me give you this to read for a minute. The guy looked at it, says, what's this? I said, I'll tell you how to go to heaven when you die and miss hell. Well, I sure need that. Amen. And you know, I stood there for the next 20 minutes sharing the gospel. They got called to the table and they didn't go. They said, well, listen to him. You can put somebody else in. And I thought, whoa. That's weird. That's wonderful. You know? And I can't say that we all bowed our head and prayed and, you know, and they all got saved. But they listened. Amen. And that's my job, is give them something to listen to. My point is, you have a commission. You have truth. And you want to be a good steward of it. Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace. May these things be a challenge to our hearts. To be faithful. In Christ's name, amen. All right, praise the Lord.